डे वन इम्प्लीमेंटिंग स्टेट मैनेजमेंट इन आयनिक एंगुलर एप्लीकेशंस। हेलो एवरीवन, माय नेम इज़ आदित्य शर्मा एंड थ्रू दिस वीडियो सीरीज आई एम गोना शेयर माय एक्सपीरियंस इम्प्लीमेंटिंग स्टेट मैनेजमेंट इन आयनिक एंगुलर एप्लीकेशंस। सो बिफोर बिगनिंग टू work on any of the libraries, this is quite important that we first make a exploration around the concept of state management and offerings of various libraries available. So before beginning to explore about the libraries, I explored whether state management is actually needed, because sometimes it happens that there are existing functionalities that are available with the frameworks or libraries that we are using, like Angular or React, and we are not aware about them. And adding an external library overkills things. So with my exploration, I found out that without state management in place, mostly we use services or providers to store our data into shared variables, and that is something used worldwide for smaller applications. But to build up a more scalable or maintainable applications, we need a state management in place. So there were various articles that I went through, and I'm sharing one of the interesting articles that I went through, and I will quickly give a gist of it through a walkthrough. So this is why state management is important for Angular applications. It is written by Bhargav Bachina. So this particular article covers following points. It first talks about how the world is without state management, then how it looks with state management, then it explains you how you can have one of the most popular state management library for Angular, NgRx, in place, how it works, and what are the other libraries available. And finally, it concludes with the disadvantages, advantages, and summary and conclusion. So let's begin. First of all, as I already conveyed, that when we are not using any of the state management libraries, we have services in place. So for most of the features, we create different services from which there are various shared variables are there, that from which we access the data. Now these kind of services that we implement have scattered data, and sometimes we need to have replicas of data, or we need to use a combination of data that comes from different services. So this is something that does not give that much of maintainability of code, and sometimes even it happens that developers have their own style of implementing such services, so which cannot be controlled by us. So now when we talk about a state management in place, so all the data is with the state management. Whenever your app wants any data, it gets it from the state management, and whenever we want to update it, we do it. So this is how it looks when we have a holistic view of different components that we have. Like if we have a profile component, user, task, payment, etc. So all the data is there in the state management, and our app is just accessing that data. Data flow direction is always one direction. So that means that if we are accessing any data, we cannot locally change it. We have to perform some actions and change it to make a change in the state. It's a immutability concept. Okay. Pre-request side. So here we are talking about NGRX library. So for that, following things are: you need to know functional programming. You should know about about reacting programming. RxJS library, TypeScript, and JavaScript ES6 and ES Next features. So with functional programming, you should be aware about pure function, immutability, data transformation, high order function, recursion, composition. These are the commonly used concepts. So one should have awareness for these kind of functions. Then about reactive programming, RxJS, that's okay, already conveyed. Now how it works. Okay, so there is a store, as most of the libraries do. See, most of the libraries are for using the flux pattern only. So we will have a store. Now this store, various components, they get data and they update data. Okay, now this store, there is a concept of effects out there in NGRX. Now what these effects are, if you want to call any of the services through which you want to make a API call, we use this effect concept in place. So when we get data from the store, if it checks whether there is some effect out there defined, so through that it calls the service and makes a API call. Similarly, these NGRX store is capable of serializing and deserializing the data from the local storage. And so if your app is not in memory and then again restart it, it automatically makes that transition of data for the states. So other than that, there are NGAccess and Akita, two libraries recommended by it. Then it talks about the advantages and disadvantages. Okay, if we talk about advantages, we have a single source of truth, data flow is one directional. If we design it well, we can avoid using numerous API call, and then syncing with the local storage is easy. So these are the advantages it talks about. Disadvantages, it does require a learning curve, right? We are using some new tools out there. So that is one of the disadvantage. Other than that, if you don't understand it well, maybe you will create something unmaintainable and clumsy. And then finally, you are adding a library, it will definitely increase the size of your bundle. So these were the pros and cons of using state management. Now based on it, we have to make a decision. So okay, finally it summarizes whatever we talked about, and it concluded that to have a more extensible and maintainable applications, we should definitely have a state management team. Okay, now after this this article that I read, as I am a big fan of Redux library, I also tried to find whether there is something available through which I can use Redux library itself. So on GitHub, I was able to get a GitHub repository which was deprecated with this particular repository. So I found this particular project, Angular Redux, that can help us to use the existing Redux library. But as it says that it's no more maintained, so I think that won't be a good decision to go for it. Okay, so then I continued my exploration with the three libraries I got: NGRX, NGXS, and Akita. So I went through the basic architecture available on with their official documentation to begin with, and I was able to get the basic architecture, like how things works. So with NGXS, it was quite simple. There were no effects, no reducers, and there were store actions. There were some plugins available out there through which things were happening, and there were selectors along with it. So this was the architecture of NGXS library. Then I went to the documentation of Akita. So this was also something similar, but here streaming data comes into play. We make a query, and through which we get the data from the store, and then based on this rendering takes place. So this was another library that I explored around. Then finally about the NGRX library. So this was the whole architecture that is available with the official documentation. We have a store, then there are selectors through which the components can get data. There are reducers, actions, effects through which we can call various services, which makes API calls to the backend. And there was some other. Now about this library, the whenever I have to choose between various libraries available out there, the approach I take is first to explore more about the community that is around it. So when I went to the GitHub repository of NGXS, the first thing I look upon is the releases. How frequently are the releases? So when I talk about NGXS, we have almost in 3 to 4 months a release out there. And we have around more than 2,000 people using it, and around 134 contributors out there. So this is really a good community out there, because community plays a crucial role. If we don't have a good community, maybe there comes a time that the repository becomes unmaintainable, as happened with Angular Redux. Then about when I talk about Akita, we have around 243 tags with a release almost in I guess 10 to 20 around 10 days, 10 to 5 days we have a release nowadays. Then the usage, we have around 800 plus people using it, and we have 54 contributors. That is something, a decent number. And when we talk about NGRX, about this, we are having around 1 or 2 months of gap between 2 to 3 months of gap between some of the releases, and some are in a month also. And a really good community of contributors of more than 200, around 300 contributors, and used by more than 39,000 people out there are using it. So that's a really good number, and I think this is one of the most popular and one of the best communities available out there. So based on this, I find that NGRX and NGXS are quite more better options to choose from. Okay. Other than that, there is one more criteria that most of the time I choose. When we talk about contributors of NGXS, we have if I see out there, we have more than four people. I think around six people who did more than 50 commits out here. So there is a thing like more people are involved into it based on this. But when I talk about Akita, here mostly Nathaniel Basil has done most of the contributions, and there are some of the contributors out there. And when we talk about NGRX, okay, here also we have around 3 to 4 people who are actively contributing. So when we have enriched community out there, that many people are contributing towards, that's much better option to choose for, because if that single person stopped contributing to that particular repository, it may happen that it is quite difficult to maintain further. It's my own personal opinion, that may not be a fact. Okay, so based on that, these factors, I chose to go for NGRX and NGXS library. So there is another post that I went through that in which one of the developers have Zura explained how they migrated from NGRX to NGXS, and what are the differences between them, and why they prefer NGXS. So first, they for each particular concept that we have in those library, in programmatically they made a comparison. So first about the actions. So in ng axis it's quite precise and small. This much makes a action. When I talk about ngrx, we have to make a, okay, this is how an action is created, implemented. Then about the state versus the reducers, effects and selectors. So in ng axis it's just a state that we have to create, but when in this state we have the selectors and actions being implemented. But when I talk about ngrx, we have to create separately reducers, then effects, effects that makes up us. Then finally, how it is used in the components. When we talk about ng axis, we are dispatching action out here, and when I talk about ngrx, similarly we dispatch action out here. Okay, so finally it concludes with some of the plugins that are available with both the libraries, and it talks about what are the experiences that they had when they migrated from there. So this was something I read. Other than that, I went through some of the questions that were available on Stack Overflow and Reddit. So these two were quite interesting. In this also, there is a reference for the Reddit question itself. So here, one of the experience that one of the person shared, like they were using ngrx, there was lots of boilerplate code, the teammates were having difficulty understanding it, and some other things, some other complexities that they were having out there. And when they migrated to ngrx, how they felt about it. So these things were there out there, and I also went through that particular post with various people out there sharing their experiences. Most of them talk about that with ngrx there is lots of boilerplate code coming out there, and ngrx is more of a simpler and precise state management library. So this was all about today's exploration on this. So I'm more of an inclined towards ngrx based on the various blocks that I read and the experiences that were shared on various platforms. So let's see how things move. Thank you.